Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This session is being videoed and it will be up on my YouTube channel probably tomorrow, maybe Monday. Stefan will have the links, and there will also be a link to a PDF of this presentation with all the notes as well. So don't feel you need to take photos of the slides, because the full thing will be there with the notes that they've amplified, because as you'll discover, there's not many words, it's mostly pictures, so the words are in the notes section. Leadership. There's lots of things we can do, but the question is, should we, and how should we do it? Particularly in the field of big data, analytics, all that sort of stuff, and as we now see with the development of AI, machine learning, all the various different aspects of AI, there's lots of things we can now do, but the question is, what should we really be doing? Should we actually be going down some of these routes? What are the ethics questions? What are the governance questions? How does GDPR affect us in just a little over 40-odd days? You guys are pretty key people, as I understand it, in your companies in terms of development of data, analytics, possibly some new machine learning, and all of those stuff. So I want to be addressing some of those issues to be, what are the questions that we should all be asking ourselves? We shouldn't just be following the herd because they're all doing it. They may also all get into trouble in one way or another. We've seen in the last week and a half a rather interesting situation with Facebook and that Cambridge Analytica. Well, Cambridge Analytica came to the notice of the pop of the world actually middle of last year, and their role in the Trump campaigns and the UK Brexit campaigns. So Cambridge Analytica have been around in the news about this ethical types of questions for quite a while. Facebook has really hit the headlines this last 3 days with Zuckerberg sitting in front and trying to answer questions, sometimes answering questions, sometimes skating around them in front of the Senate committee. I want to also look at the how big data analytics have been used these days as a source, or at least being sold as a source for innovation and transformation. Is this real? Is it real for some people and not for others? And how do we know whether we could be the ones who are successful? How do we learn from those who have not been successful? And a theme at the background is this GDPR context. In terms of topics, I want to look at aspects of leadership. It's part of the title of this session, Leadership and Development. So what does leadership mean? How can we all use it in ways that are appropriate to what we're doing, our teams? I want to then look at how that's worked out in my life, because over the last 4 years, I suddenly ended up places like this. Now, there are very, very few academics, or full-time academics, who actually come out and get involved in these sort of roles, in these sort of conferences. How did that happen to me? Because 5 years ago, I wouldn't have believed I'd be standing in front of a group of analytics professionals in Germany, and Copenhagen, and Vienna, and Zurich, and Helsinki last year. How's that happened? It was because someone, a leader, was a true leader, empowered me to go do, try things out. And the third part is analytics governance. Thinking particularly about trust and ethics in those two topic areas. So to start, as you manage your teams, how do you look at management? Do you manage in the way that a European shepherd does from behind with your sheepdogs, kind of rounding up these recalcitrant people in front of you to make them go in about the right direction? Or do you use a millennial-old approach from the Middle East? The shepherd walks in front and all the sheep or the goats follow. which are you at the moment, and which would you like to be? I know which I would like to be is this one, having my students following me, having them inspired and enthused to do their research and then their critical thinking, their critical analysis, choosing mini projects that they are passionately interested in. And this is a very different approach to what I've been using beforehand, where I would give them much narrower topics that they all did. And that's, they would see that, well, that's Richard's idea. I'm very interested in that, I suppose I'll do something. Now, here's a big project. Find the bit that you can are interested in. And then you can research it and come up with some really interesting information, conclusions. And the results? Students work hard, they achieve better. Now, how would you like your staff to achieve better? Let's have a look. Five ways or five attributes of a leader, some interesting ones, not necessarily the only ones. Vision, passion, walking the talk, communications, and courage. Five things that as leaders, we need to be able to do. We have to have a vision of the direction we want to go, the thing we want to achieve, the way that we want ourselves to be, our team to be. Come to the vision that you get your approach to ethics, the approach to this is the right way to do things in society, perhaps. Your vision sets your long-term strategy. Think of Walmart as a company. They're one of the few that I know of where they still have as one of their core strategies, one that has been there since 1965 or so when Samsung created the company. To be the most cost-effective supermarket chain in the world. So that's what, 52 years, that strategy has stayed unchanged. That's a true strategy if it stays there for that long. And that vision for being cost effective is still there. Do we have that sort of vision, that sort of long-term approach to how we want to be as an organisation, as a team? Are we passionate about our vision? If we aren't, we will not convert our teams to follow us. I guess almost everyone here has been through a change management program of some sort or other in your company. How many of those change programs have you been through? Every 4 or 5 years? Get the new, maybe every 2 or 3 years, this is the next thing we have to do, customer first, with one that I remember from the 1980s. And through these, unless you are passionate, your message will kind of get into that blah sort of feeling from most people, not again. If you're not passionate, why would they buy the deal from you? Too many people are very, very good at talking the talk, but very rarely walk the talk of the walk. But if you do not walk the talk, you will be rumbled very, very quickly, and your message will be rejected. Your cynicism will be understood. But as part of that passion and the vision, you need to understand how to communicate. That at all times, the responsibility for the audience hearing and understanding the message is yours as the communicator. You cannot, as one UK politician did a year or I haven't engaged with you, yeah, you're freely welcome to go to sleep, or, you know, if I've not caught your attention with my passion, my vision, my communication, and you go, that's my fault, not yours. And of course, in our field, in much change, most fields where there's change, that leader has to have a degree of courage, because not everyone's going to buy in. It's going to be difficult sometimes to even sell it to those up there, the bosses. And you have to be quite courageous sometimes, because things are going to go wrong. You have to be able to get past those difficult areas. You've got to have some courage. But is this all enough? These are things that I kind of found with the leader who helped me to get to where I am today. But I came across something on LinkedIn last week from a guy called Ed Brimmer. This comes from military philosophy, mission control, mission command. How many times, when we have been parts of teams, have we been told not just what to achieve, but how to achieve it? If we want to unlock the passion, the enthusiasm, the training, the expertise of our teams, we want them to be imaginative and innovative, which means you don't tell them how to do the job. You tell them what the task is. In this one, how do we get across the river? If it's a very narrow one, you can jump across it. If it's a bigger one, some sort of a bridge might be appropriate. If it's a very big one, and as I was coming up the river on the train, up by the river yesterday from Frankfurt Airport, there was a ferry. The river's too big to put a bridge across. So there's lots of different solutions. But if we just want to get from this side to the other side, go talk to your team, give them the challenge, tell them what you want to achieve, and let them come up with the best recommendation, and then go implement it to the best of their ability. Don't constrain them in the ways that those other three boxes give you. So, have you looked a little bit about what leadership could be? I want you to think for yourselves, what sort of leadership are you giving at the moment? Where do you want to get to, and how should you get there? I may be teaching quite a few people, I'll ask quite a few people to suck eggs, but hey, some of the people here may not have come across these questions. So what happened to me? Well, I was at Rolls-Royce Aerospace for 30 odd years, an undergrad apprentice, went through university, and was there until 2000 or thereabouts. Then I came to the University of Derby, where I'd been a senior lecturer for that time. But what happened 3 or 4 years ago? Was that I was inspired and empowered by my dean to do things differently, to not ask permission to do things, have the idea it was good enough, go do it, it might fail, it might not, if it fails I'll learn, if I do, if I succeed, I will also learn. He did not want me to ask him permission to do stuff, which was kind of interesting. What it allowed me to do was to switch from the classic university academic perspective of the academic who knows the domain, the academic who is going to transfer knowledge and information into the heads of the students. Look back at your own careers if you went to university. Did sitting in front of a lecturer for an hour help you to learn anything? It turns out it's not the most effective way of getting people to learn. You can't. You can take a horse to the water, but you can't make him drink. You can take students to the knowledge. You can tip it in one ear, if not the other ear. If you want the knowledge to stick, it turns out they have to go find it. They have to interact with it. They have to critically evaluate it. They have to do research and apply their knowledge. It doesn't work very well just standing spouting for an hour or two about some stuff which is really fascinating to you, So it meant I got away from managing my students, trying to make sure they got to the lectures and the workshops and the seminars. I poured this interesting stuff to me into their ears. Turned it into something very, very different. I became an academic as learning to learn expert, a mentor, a guide, an inspirer of students. Turns out that academics who work like that are actually much, much more successful. At least their students are much, much more successful. It's like creating a team and getting them to do things. I have my students now, these last 3 or 4 years, working right at the leading edge of governance questions. So this year, they're just about to finish off their assignment, which is blockchain applications, questions of ethics, trust, governance, audit, provenance, opportunities and benefits, and so on. And they're all choosing different blockchain applications that is interesting to them. They are raising interesting questions that no one in the world is writing about at the moment. They are ahead of everybody about the questions, the governance questions of the use of blockchain. They're critically evaluating whether it can even work in some of the applications that are being proposed at the moment. They love it because they're getting to look at stuff that no one else is doing. They know that I will be incorporating some of their ideas into these sessions like this, and that where appropriate, they will get their name mentioned. And they really take to this sort of approach. So I was inspired and led and empowered to do these different ways. But then I've had some of my lectures, seminars were on YouTube, and someone at the management events found it and sort of said, hey, Richard, you'd like to come out to speak at one of our sessions down in Barcelona. From which then, last year I went to 5 different countries with management events sessions. Entirely accidental. Now, if you are going to be a leader involved in advanced technologies like AI, blockchain, machine learning, whatever, there are no answers. I am not going to teach you answers. I provide a lot of questions based on 40 odd years of seeing what happens, experiencing what happens. It's skepticism. It may sound at times a little bit like cynicism, but it's based on so much experience. It is a skeptical approach that everyone needs to develop. Prove it to me. So I'll be giving you some of those questions that you will be able to pose to your types of projects to prove to you that the project might have some chance of success. You see, this comes from the UK Companies Act from 2006, the responsibilities of legal directors. I want to think of just 2 of them. What are the consequences of your decisions in the longer term? And what, essentially, to paraphrase the second one, what are the consequences in terms of your business reputation? Because we know of companies who have had some pretty serious reputational problems over the last 2 or 3, 4 years. There was Uber last year with Kalanick and his ranting at their driver and all those things that went on last year. The toxic gender problem. And now they've managed to kill someone through their testing program when they switched off their LiDAR at night time to test out the accurate effectiveness of their use of cameras for controlling the car. So the camera couldn't see the person in time. You have Facebook, which we've been sort of kind of thinking about desultorily for a few years, but now it's really blown up in the last 2-3 weeks. 87 million sets of data stolen from Facebook and given to Cambridge Analytica and others apparently. He's in front of the Senate at the moment. He could, if the Federal Trade Commission really decided to show its teeth, get fined something between $2 and $3 trillion. 5% of world GDP, folks, that is. That's an interesting level of fine. But $40,000 per person. Cambridge Analytica, the Trump and Brexit campaigns, we've seen that as well. And things are getting complicated in my app. The Facebook ethos. How many have seen this, the text of this message from Andrew Bosler at Facebook last year, a couple of years ago? It's worth reading. Remember, Facebook are there. Claim to be there to connect people, because connecting people is good, apparently. And anything that's bad that happens through this connection is not my fault, says Zuckerberg or Bosler. It's their fault for misusing my technology platform. A little bit more background there. Now, what's going on in Cambridge Analytica is based on some work that Michael Kaczynski carried out, which showed that with 69 likes, your 69 likes on Facebook tells him to, with about 88% accuracy, the colour of your skin. 150 likes, and Facebook knows you better than your parents do. Which is kind of interesting. And it seems that some of that approach was incorporated by Cambridge Analytica in their psychic profiling. Maybe not the exact Kaczynski stuff, but similar things. And what they're doing in the Trump campaign, they were creating one particular event, 170-something thousand different, subtly different SMS messages based on those different profiles of people through their Facebook likes. And that had some interesting implications, because in the West we are traditionally used to seeing political advertising on paper, on TV, properly signposted. This is the something or other party, and this is our message to you. So, yeah, we can take it or leave it, because we can see who it is, which politician is speaking, or which group of people are speaking on behalf of who. And we can ignore it or listen to it as we wish. When you're getting SMSs and Facebook content poured at you, very rarely in this particular field is it labelled the Republican Party or the Trump campaign. It was just stuff, and it wasn't even obviously related to Trump necessarily. And they were, some of them were wildly different. Some of that 173,000 were highly positive about something. Others, the other people, would be highly negative. Now, with traditional advertising, everybody sees the same stuff. So in the UK, the Labour Party candidate in our part of the town puts out the same piece of paper that every single household. We all see it. With what Analytica were doing, Cambridge Analytica were doing, every single one of us in the ward would have seen something slightly different, or very different. And this is a problem here, is the lack of transparency of what's going on, so we don't recognise that it is an advert. That's what's really problematic in this one. A bit more context. GDPR. You all know that GDPR hits us big time in about 40 days or so. 6 weeks ish. There are five critical issues which are relevant to everyone in here about analytics. The fact that big data analytics uses algorithms. Well, let's face it, all the analytics and machine learning and everything else is just often rather advanced application of pretty advanced statistics. There's nothing magical about it, it's just lots of clever algorithms. But what is problematic from the GDPR perspective in terms of profiling, use of personally identifiable information, is the fact that many of these technologies are incredibly opaque. We cannot understand exactly what they're doing in ways that we can explain to people in words of two syllables. Why has that algorithm made that particular decision and refused you a loan, or refused you an insurance policy, or tripled your insurance policy? Like in the UK just recently, some algorithms were somehow looking at your name. And if your first name was Mustafa or Muhammad, as compared to Richard, your car insurance quote would be £200 or £300 a year different. The insurance company said, we've not programmed that. Opacity and process. We have a tendency to collect every little bit of data we can. We are squirrels. And that can be a problem in terms of informed consent. We repurpose data. We caught it for this. We declare to the customers it's used for that. And then we think, if we add it to this, we can do something much more interesting. We've seen that, haven't we? And we like using lots of new types of data. That's one of the fundamental issues. And background. A little bit more kind of backgroundy stuff as well, but leading on into the question of governance. Look at success or otherwise of our IT-related projects, whether traditional enterprise-type systems or analytics. And more interestingly for some of you, things like the ultra-height environments such as blockchain, which is now hitting the world. And look at also the problem of veracity of our data. How much can we trust it? And then we'll look a little bit at advanced algorithms. Now, how many of you have seen data from the Standish Group about project success and failure? The chaos reports. The first one came out in 1994, and they identified projects as being successful, challenged, or failed on some fairly simple criteria that they then went out to lots and lots and lots of chief information officers around the world to report on the success and failure of their projects. Success for the blue line up till 2012 was on time, to budget, delivering the signed for functionality, contracted for functionality. Failed, or ones obviously failed, and it turned out that the green and the top blue line, the challenge projects, were ones which were typically late over budget and delivered about 40% of the contracted for functionality. Now, CIOs eventually got a bit tired of being held to the task for delivering the contracted for functionality from a project from 5 years old, because the world changes, it's getting faster and faster. So why not change it to delivering business value? So they changed it and backfitted it for the previous 2 years. Because of course the CIO is expected to improve their success rate from 37-38% to something higher. What was interesting, when they changed to on time, to budget, delivering business value, and you can see it dropped the success rate by 10%. Now I'm not entirely sure I can understand, can actually give a narrative of why that should be, other than that perhaps on time, to budget, and delivering contracted functionality wasn't actually of delivering any business value. So that may be a problem. Interesting though. Now, the consequences we're seeing for the best part of 15 years or more, we have learned nothing from each other. It's how to improve the success rate of our IT-related projects. Now, most of these in here will almost certainly be standard sorts of enterprise. It turns out that analytics type projects fit this model exactly as well. It was reported at one of the IBM analytics conferences in Las Vegas 3 years ago that all these many, many big data analytics projects, only about 50% were successful, similar to this sort of level. So this raises the question, what should we be doing to raise the success rate? Having talked to quite a lot of people over the last 6 months, one of the things that's beginning to come clear to me is that one of the problems is we're actually launching too many projects with too little resource. Because in 2003-04, one of the chaos reports pointed out that the successful projects had got their estimates from the team, their professional best estimates, which of course will include, you know, contingency for the unknowables about these sort of projects. But the projects that were successful had 150% additional contingency added in. So the budgets, the numbers of people, and timescales, and then project manage like crazy. Now that, plus what I've been talking to people about recently, suggests we're launching too many projects because we are not thinking carefully enough at the beginning which project should we put all of our money into. Shouldn't we have every three projects we've got, which is the one we're going to run with, and we'll move all that proposed budget from those two that we're not doing into the one that we are going to do. How many of you have experienced, like I have, Richard, that's far too expensive and going to take far too long and far too many people. Reduce the budget by 30% and the number of people by 30%. Oh, and by the way, do it in half the time as well. Anybody been there? Almost everybody of you been there. And the result is, it's extraordinarily difficult to deliver anything, let alone value. Why don't we change the way we approach things? And this becomes really important in the field of analytics into the enterprise level. And the uses we're going to be using, machine learning, we've heard that in those talks just before lunch about the way that they can use machine learning in the TV environment. We need to start small. Experiment. You'll see this developing over the next few slides. But how do we get out of that bottom line, the catastrophic failure, the challenge at the top where essentially we're wasting almost all of the money, to concentrate on that middle line, the few that really deliver that benefit and can be made successful? I think we can do a lot better. Now we look at data. The thing that drives everything we're here to talk about, an amazing range of different sources, IoT-like devices, point-of-sales things, data stored in SAP-type enterprise resource planning system, etc., etc., data coming from our smart devices, Fitbits, etc., and the social media and video. All sorts of sources, which is an incredible range of data to be playing with, to be analysing, to be structuring, to be taken out of the data lake and put into the data warehouse, the proper structured metadata environment where we really trust the data as far as we can because we understand it really, really well. But of all of that data, how much can we be absolutely certain that the data are correct? And how much of the data actually are we unable to say for certain is right or wrong? By how much they're right or wrong. It turns out, when I first saw this about 5 years ago, I thought, all the enterprise data is okay. Because I've been through an ERP implementation with data cleanse, 70% of the master data out of the legacy system before we put it into SAP. Within 5 years, that company was running a data cleansing exercise, an almost continuous data cleansing exercise on the SAP. Even your enterprise master data and all the derived data, etc., is getting dirty. Unless you're actively data cleansing. Now, the point about it from analytics is, to what extent are the decisions that you want to make with your analyses affected by a varying level of accuracy? I'm not advocating that we don't do the analytics, but we need to understand the sensitivity of our decision-making processes to the levels of inaccuracy in our data. To give you an example, we all know location services on our smartphones. And we know that various organizations like to target us with adverts, if we've opted in, depending on where we are. Now, I had groups of students for about 3 years looking at the accuracy of location tagging with the photos on their smartphones. And it turns out the accuracy is variable across types of phones and generations of phones, where you are and so on. But the average is around about 85% of your locations are tagged accurately about 85% of the time, at least of the 2,500 photos that we took, which is, by the way, the largest collection of data ever collected about this topic. there are about 85% within 25 metres. That's not a deal there. The question is, what about the remaining 15%, which is from 25 metres to, would you believe, at least 1,800 kilometres error on occasion? A company called Thignia, who was doing a huge exercise in America with billions of location tagged adverts, discovered 15% roughly of all location targeted adverts were going to phones which were more than 60 miles, 100 kilometers, from where the phone actually was. They were reporting where they were 100 kilometers error, 15% of the time. Now that, it's at that level it becomes consequential. The ones down in the 100 yard meters, 200 meters, 300 meters, it's neither here nor there. But when you're targeting someone in Cologne with an advert, which is effective down the road in Bonn, you kind of get a bit irritated as a receiver. Because I'm not there, I'm here in Cologne, not in Bonn. So you begin to suffer beginnings of reputational damage, beginnings of irritation by the users. So you need to characterize the levels of error in your systems more carefully. Now that we know that 80% of the data is of uncertain veracity, that's not saying it's wrong, it's just we don't know whether right or wrong. And that may have important consequences in understanding what our analyses are all about and the contents of our analyses. Yeah, they're all inaccurate. Anything that measures anything is inaccurate to some extent. There is always noise in the readings, whether it's the fact that step counter between two devices can be up to 30% different between your Garmin Fitbit and your iPhone. 30% error between the two, quite easily. Which has some interesting consequences if you're trying to work out, for heaven's sake, how many calories you've burnt. Because we've all got different bodies, different shapes, different efficiencies in the way our body works, and our metabolism actually changes with time. So a kilometre run one day might burn X thousand calories, another day it might burn Y thousand calories. Even running at the same pace and so on. Our bodies are like that. Even an engine oil condition monitoring off a jet engine like that top sensor, there is always some degree of noise on that sensor in its readings. So if you see it jittering like that, don't assume that the oil pressure is going like that as well. It might not be, it might just be noise. Electronics has noise because above a temperature of absolute zero, the electrons do their own thing to some extent. So everything carries with it some level of error. The question we have to think about as we use our systems, our analytics, is what level of error is in there? What level of noise is in the signal, and how does that affect the cognitive decisions we want to make based on the data? No more than that, no less. Just recognize that we may not be able to completely trust all of our data. Do we actually understand the data we've got in our data lake? Or have we just been hoofing up all the data just so that we've got it? Do we know what all the data in our data lake means? Have we actually extracted the relevant bits, structured it, metadated it, etc., 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 so that we can actually use it properly in a way that we can trust? Do we have any clue? How many of you use clustering technology in your analytics or your teams do? So you know what the cosine, how relevant the cosine difference between things is. It's a way that clustering technology, analytics or technology, works out the difference between an espresso and a cappuccino. Well, it's obviously worked out espressos and cappuccinos are coffee as distinct from tea. But not being able to distinguish the two is kind of a problem for human beings who know very fundamentally the difference between an espresso and a cappuccino and a longo and etc. etc. We have to be careful where we use our really clever statistics technologies much more carefully than many organisations are doing so at the moment. There's a story from a few years back about trying to train an AI system, a visual recognition system, to distinguish between enemy and friendly tanks. They did the project correctly, lots and lots of data, lots and lots of photos for the training set and the reserve subset for the test set. And they proved that it was working, except someone discovered that, unfortunately, bearing in mind this is for a missile type of system, that it hadn't learned anything about tanks whatsoever. It only learned about the background, the desert, and the forest. Or, if it's a different story, depending on which version, clouds and blue sky. Or, as I was told just after the last time I did this, about an hour ago, there's an agency in Germany doing a wolf picture recognition system to understand the difference between a wolf and a dog. And they accidentally discovered that what it actually learned was to distinguish between snow and grass as a background. But you see, that what happened for Joy Bullen Winnie was she was wanting to use an AI vision recognition system to detect her face. And it couldn't, because she was too dark. It was seriously racist. Because presumably the training data set had only gone about as far as, nobody here who's sort of dark enough to be in the cutoff level, but you know, I've got students who are either side of where the presumed cutoff might be. It just hadn't done it. We know what's happening, where the Tesla vehicles are, doing some really nasty things, occasionally killing people. About three people have been killed in Tesla, one now. Three drivers in Tesla have been killed, and the one pedestrian by Uber a couple of weeks ago. The top left hand is a Tesla, which was doing 60 miles an hour, so close on 80k, and ran straight into the back of a stationary fire engine. Kind of interesting. What's going wrong? How has the training failed? Ethics comes in here as well, because we're now getting stuck. We can do it. We can detect the criminal versus the non-criminal. We can detect male and female separately. We can identify whether they are gay or not. The problem is, of course, that partly the problem is that the 9% false negative or false positive with the accuracy for males, and 83% accuracy for women, only 10.5% inaccuracy on the criminality one. Now, we can do it. Should we have even tried that? Now, there's a problem with academic freedom and so on. If it's possible, someone will do it. We can't actually ban research. Should we be using it? I can think of various countries who would be very happy to employ this sort of technology, either on the streets or at immigration. Sorry, sir, we don't accept your type. Could you go back on the plane? Sorry, madam. Not very good. But there are lots of other things. There was Target in 2012, eventually, who were predicting, identifying who was pregnant of all of their female customers. Even 16-year-olds. This caused a bit of a problem. A reputational hit to the company, which is quite severe at the time. So, with all that background, where are we going to go in the next few years? Well, AI machine learning is really getting big in our business processes. We're now getting indications and some whispers of melding together AI and the blockchain, because the blockchain is the next biggest hype you've ever come across, some of which will work out, particularly in the trusted business-to-business environment. How much the rest, I'm not entirely sure at the moment. We already know that if you hold the complete Bitcoin blockchain on your hard drive, you are holding illegal material. They've managed to insert in there 247 links to child pornography. Holding child pornography on a hard disk is illegal in about 121 countries. Interesting question. But more importantly about blockchain is, and I'll just illustrate in a minute, is how sparse the data actually is in it. That's where we're going. Would we really want to go for AI and blockchain? I'm not sure. But there's some interesting questions you can ask yourself to decide whether you wish to go in that direction. And in trust. And this is kind of where GDPR comes back into the question. Do we understand our machine learning models? And how are we addressing the problem of data bias and the testing and training biases? So that's kind of a very, very simplified little neural network. But look how many connections there are. There's only four layers, five layers in there, three hidden layers, an input layer, and an output layer with four different categories. Very difficult to explain what's happening in that left-hand one. But in the right-hand, the traditional algorithmic approach, if-then-else type of stuff. Well, we can read it, we can understand it, we can explain it very, very easily. We can prove to our compliance officers that we've done it right. We can prove that the decisions being made are correct and compliant with regulations, etc. On the left, we have no idea whether the connections which are developed are causal or just pure happenstance, coincidence, and correlation. Looking at the blockchain aspect, blockchain, essentially, the distributed ledger is just a list of messages. I move this amount of value from A, party A, to party B. It could be bitcoins, it could be a binary package, which might be executable as a smart contract, it might be text message, or it might be any arbitrary package. But essentially, it's source, destination, and some value is a typical one. How sparse is that? Would you ever, in your business, run even the most trivial bit of statistical predictive analytics on your accounting journal? No. We want richer data. We'd be looking at the proper system tables and files, where you've got rich data. So why would we want to put blockchain together with AI? There may be a good reason. But start asking the questions. Just don't follow the hype, the fact that somebody's come up with the idea that it ought to be useful. Remember, it is incredibly sparse data compared with that richness of data you already have in your corporate data warehouses and data corporate systems and so on. So think very carefully. Even as business to business, blockchain is only going to provide you an immutable record of what the messages were. It doesn't do anything else for you at the moment. It might be developed. There's one that's kind of a bit different, which might be more useful, perhaps. But GDPR needs us to be able to explain to people who have had an adverse decision made against them. Now, either you look at neural networks, which is, as I said, very simple, this one, difficult to understand. Huge numbers of matrices of high order dimensionality, lots of weighting factors to look over that. But even with your regression analysis, if you've got more than about three of those factors in there, up to X3, it becomes immensely difficult to explain how it's come to the decision. You know, you've got 100 columns, 100 variables, X1 to X100. And there are all those weighting factors. How can I use that to explain to, maybe in financial services, a person coming for a loan, that all those betas are all about similar. Which one was it that failed you, your loan application? Whereas on the right-hand side, that's easy to explain, isn't it? You failed where it dropped out here. The only thing is, if you take that right-hand one, it takes time and effort. Typically, in financial services, through the whole compliance process, it's going to take you, 6 months, 12 months? It's probably going to cost you, through all the processes and implementation, the odd million or $2. But the left-hand one says, we give it all the data from all the decisions we made over the last 6 months or 12 months. Humans have made that decision, by the way. And it will learn over a period of 2 or 3 weeks if we're lucky. So you've got a speed up and a cost reduction on the left-hand side compared with the proper, transparent, compliant way on the right-hand side. Where do you want to be on the GDPR, for example, might be an interesting question. You might just, if you're using AI technologies, you might just slowly do that because you can't explain it. But you have to be able to explain it. So the answers, partly, well, to give them their due, the AV companies are trying to get or provide some safety with shadow driving. Doesn't always work, as we saw. Some are going on the simulation route, but the other very, very important thing is to ensure that you have more comprehensive data, that you've got all the data, or every representative face and type for that face recognition, for example. So, fundamental question. What sort of leadership are you going to do? If you're going to change, do you need to change? And why? And then what will you do with all these questions I've been giving you over the last three quarters of an hour or so? A few key books you ought to read. You'll be able to see the titles when you get the access to the PDF. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Well, I should be around afterwards until around about 4:15, 4:30 when I need to leave. So, thank you very much for listening, folks. Thank you.
Von daher würde ich Sie bitten, um 14:45 Uhr wieder hier im Seminar Halle 1. Danke.